Hachette Audio presents The Fighter, written by Michael Farris Smith, read by Graham Halstead. For my family. To be alive at all is to have scars. John Steinbeck. When he was 2 years old, the boy was dropped off at the donation door at the Salvation Army secondhand store in Tunica, wearing nothing but a sagging diaper. A Planet of the Apes backpack stuffed with more diapers and some shirts and mismatched socks, and little green army man was dropped on the ground next to him. Then a hungover woman banged a scabbed fist on the metal door, and a hungover man blew the car horn, and she ran around and got in as the child watched with a docile expression. Out of the car window, the man called out some sort of farewell to the child that was lost in the offbeat chug of the engine, and then the foul-running Cadillac rattled out of the gravel parking lot, leaving the child in the dust cloud of abandonment. The door opened, and two women in matching red Salvation Army t-shirts stared down at the boy. Then they looked into the parking lot at the still lingering cloud, out into a gray morning sky. They glanced at each other, and then one said, "I guess we're gonna have to hang a sign next to the one that says no mattresses, that says no youngins." The other woman lifted the boy and held him up beneath his arms as if to make certain he was made of actual flesh and bone. When she was satisfied, she hugged the child close and rubbed her hand across the back of his head, and she said, "I pity those who have to live behind me in this weary and heartless world." The police were called, and while they waited, the women washed the boy in the bathroom sink with paper towels and hand soap. Filthy feet and filthy hands, and the diaper was two changes past due. After they had wiped him clean and filled the trash can with dirty paper towels, the boy stood naked and fresh on the smooth concrete floor of the bathroom, and they admired his innocence and beauty. He was then dressed in a new diaper and a Spider-Man shirt taken from a rack in the kids' section. The boy did not cry and did not talk, but instead sat satisfied between the women on a tweed sofa marked $15, as if he had already decided that this was his new home and he was better off. He was better off, but this was the beginning of a childhood spent in the company of strangers. The next 10 years saw him move from one Delta town to the next. 4 foster homes and 2 group homes, 5 different schools, a handful of caseworkers, teachers whose names he could not remember, and then stopped trying to remember because he knew he would not be in their classrooms for long. The steady and certain build of restlessness and anxiety in this child, who was certain neither where he had come from nor where he was going. When he was 12 years old, the assistant director of the group home told him to gather his things again. He sat on the bench seat of a white van with the home logo on the side, and he watched the fields of soybeans and corn stalks with sullen eyes as he was driven from the sleepy, bricked street town of Greenwood to his 5th foster home. Moving northwest and closer to the Great River, to the fringes of Clarksdale, the once bustling Delta hub of trade and commerce that now wore the familiar faded expression of days gone by. His eyes changed when the van pulled into the dirt driveway that led to a 2-story home. A white antebellum with a porch stretching across the front on the bottom and top floors. Flaking paint on the sun side and vines hanging in baskets along the porch with their twisted and green trails swaying in the wind. A woman sat in a rocker and she rose to meet them. She wore work gloves, and she pulled them off and tossed them on the ground as she approached the van, as if readying herself for whatever may be climbing out. She took him to his upstairs room and opened the dresser drawers to show him where he could put his things, and he told her there was no use. "I won't be here long enough to mess up the covers on the bed." "Sure you will," she answered. "No, I won't," he said, a 12-year-old certain of the workings of the world. Are you gonna run away? I don't know. Are you? Because unless you run away, this is where you live now.
So you think.
So I know, she said. You don't know nothing, he said, and he walked out of the bedroom and down the stairs and out into the backyard. She stood at the window and watched him between the slit in the curtains. He did not stop in the backyard, but crossed it and walked out onto the dirt road that ran on and on between the rows of cotton. The sun high, and a short shadow followed him. She did not chase. She stood in the window and watched until he was nearly out of sight, and she was one step toward the door to run after him when he stopped, a tiny figure in the distance. He stopped and stayed in the same spot for several more minutes, and she could not know that he was talking to himself, telling himself, I don't want to do this no more. I don't know why I can't have somebody. With the space between them, she could not have noticed that he looked back at the big house and said, that place right there don't want me neither, and that woman can't catch me. I'm gonna take off running, and she won't never catch me. Won't nobody. I don't want to do this shit no more. She could not have heard him or seen him with any detail, but she waited. Only could see that he had stopped. She whispered a prayer without moving her lips, as if even the slightest flutter would spook the boy and send him fleeing on furious and reckless feet. He stood still, talking to himself, and she stood still, whispering a quiet and motionless prayer. And then, from the distant sky, a hawk flew toward the boy. It flew low, and its wings were spread wide, and when it reached the vicinity of the boy, it swooped and seemed to hold there out in front of him, begging the boy to admire its eloquence, begging the boy to notice something other than himself and his troubles, begging the boy to think of something other than running from that woman. The hawk rose and fell again, and the boy saw it, and his eyes followed the hawk as it turned long and graceful curves in the blue-white sky. From the window, Marianne spied the hawk, and she shifted her eyes from sky to land, waiting to see what the boy would do. The breath she had been holding was let go when the hawk turned toward the house, and the boy followed. Round one. 1. He passed through Vicksburg at midnight, the dull lights of the non-stop convenience stores and fast food restaurants fading in the rearview mirror as he drove onto Highway 61 and made his way north and into the Delta. The great alluvial plain spanning for thousands of acres, centuries of flooding from the Mississippi River creating deposits of the most fertile soil in the world. Soil that for generations had made many rich and many more poor. Hundreds of flat miles, haunts of slaves and soldiers. A land of the forgotten, covered by boundless skies. Between his legs, a pint of wild turkey. Between his fingers, a skinny wood-tipped cigar. In the cup holder, a gas station cup of coffee. On the passenger seat, an open plastic bag with 2 dozen red pills that killed the pain. His eyes scattered and alive, and his cigar hand tapping the steering wheel to the stiff metal beat from the radio and the thumpity thump of the uneven highway, half wired, half drunk, fully loaded. There were few other headlights, and out on the empty highway, he floated from his lane and into the other and back again as if the truck itself was bored with the night. On the seat next to the bag of pills was an open box of the wood-tipped cigars, a pile of shirts and jeans. The belt he had taken off as he hurried across the parking lot of the casino in Natchez a couple of hours before. Getting to the truck and opening the door, removing his belt and tossing it inside and shoving the envelope of cash into the glove box and driving away before anyone found the man he left lying face down on the bathroom floor. The truck seat and floor were littered with shiny cartridges to a pistol he no longer owned, and crumpled pawn shop receipts, and a spiral notebook filled with dates and names and notes he had written to himself. By each name he had written friend or foe. By each address, he had written safe or stay away. The pages were filled with fragments of directions and phone numbers, and what he owed, and who he owed it to, and other notes he had written out of frustration or anger or despair. Notes to remind him of which world he belonged to. Two pages were committed to Marianne and only Marianne. Half sentences about her deterioration and when he had last seen her. Tucked behind the pages for Marianne was the folded foreclosure notice, and across the top of the notice were check marks to keep track of the days, because the clock was ticking. He had looked at the notice before he drove out of the casino parking lot, and he had been gone from Clarksdale for 22 days. 8 left before the notice of sale would be delivered. He was not yet so detached from his own memory to need every note and name and warning, but he was preparing for that day to arrive as chunks of his past had disappeared, and little by little the recent had begun to flake away as if skinned with a sharp and shiny blade. He smoked the cigar to the tip, and then let down the window, and the night air whipped and momentarily chased the squalid smell out of the truck cab. He tossed the cigar butt, and an orange trail of sparks danced and disappeared into the night. He drank from the wild turkey and drove a little faster, drank from the coffee cup and turned down the radio. A pinch in his shoulder as he reached for the dial, a grip in his lower back as he situated in the seat. The clock read 12:27, and he tried to remember how long it had been since the last pill, and he reached over into the plastic bag and took a tiny red one. He popped it into his mouth and chased it with the bourbon, and reared back his head and stretched his neck, and his eyes watered as the pill and liquor went down hot. The wind was strong in the window, and he leaned out and spit, and then rolled it up. Opened the glove box and took out the envelope to make sure it was still there. That he hadn't imagined it. It was a folded manila envelope with the Magnolia Bluffs casino logo in the top left corner, a sprawling magnolia flower that spoke more to debutantes than roulette. He steadied the steering wheel with his knees and opened the envelope and took out 2 stacks of cash, 5 grand each. A rubber band held a smaller stack of bills, and he looked at the 3 stacks, smelled them, stuck them back into the envelope. He took out the note he had written to himself. 12K, straight to Big Mama's suite. He stuck the note in the front pocket of his jeans and the envelope into the glove box, and then he took out the photograph of the woman and child. He flipped on the light in the truck cab and looked at himself and Marianne as they stood in front of his first car. A boy of 16 with his shirt off, brown from the sun. Her knee-high skirt and her sandals and her hair dirty blonde but beginning to show silver streaks, and each with a hand propped on top of the hatchback. Rusted bumper and the hood a different color from the rest of the car, but bought and paid for. Still a year before he stepped into the cage for the first time. Another 20 years before her mind betrayed her to the point of being a risk to herself. Still time for us both to be saved, he thought. His life was filled with drug dealers and illegal gamblers and men who killed dogs with other dogs and fighters, like himself, who lived in violent and unforgiving worlds. There had been women, and even when he had found a small sympathy or something tender, he knew that it was not true but part of the trade. The only one who loved him was sitting in a nursing home in Clarksdale and could no longer recognize his face or his name, and he had betrayed her beyond even his own imagination. But he had 8 days to bring her home. He turned the photograph over. In recent ink, he had written, "Me and Marianne." He brushed a thumb across the words and then set the photograph on top of the casino envelope, turned off the light. For 3 weeks, he had crossed the Mississippi River back and forth between Natchez and Vidalia, hiding out in a motel room in Vidalia and driving over the bridge and to the casino when he had enough cash to play, getting hot and going cold, and then going to the abandoned sawmill on the outskirts of Vidalia when he was flat busted, where the moon stared down upon the empty land.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.